أنا سوري، أنا عندي أطفال مريضين اثنين من سوريا. أنا صار لي 6 سنين هون بعاني من مشفى لمشفى.
We received this video not long after Donald Trump issued a temporary travel ban against citizens of 7 Muslim-majority countries. Syrian refugees were also banned indefinitely. It's a plea from a Syrian father in Turkey, desperate to bring his family to America. At a time the government decided it didn't want them.
My name is Abdul Ghani Abdul Jawad, and my son is Yahya Abdul Jawad. And I have the name of the second child, age 2. اسمه عبد الجواد عبد الجواد ونسأل الله الفرج بركي تساعدوني يا أساتذة يعني مشان موضوعي أنا موضوعي على أساس مستعجل كتير ووضع أولادي سيء كتير 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 للغاية وهي وضع أولادي هاي ابني المريض اللي عمره 2 تقولوا عمره 6 شهور ما له علاجه هاي مرضه وهي السيرونات وهلأ أنا في المستشفى هي مستشفى وهي أجهزة وهي ابني الثاني عمره 7 سنين.
This is a story about a race against time and the consequences of a blanket policy that closes America's doors to those with the most to lose. We came to Istanbul a week after the executive order was signed to meet the Syrian refugee in the video.
I'm establishing new vetting measures to keep radical Islamic terrorists out of the United States of America. We don't want them here. We only want to admit those into our country who will support our country and love deeply our people. Protection of the nation from foreign terrorist entry into the United States. That's big stuff.
The Syrian man, Abdul Ghani, said he'd been cleared to come to the U.S. with his family on February 1st, but they're now unable to. He met us outside of a hospital where his 2 sons were being treated for a rare genetic disorder.
What does he have on his skin? And is it getting worse? So he didn't look like this when he was born, it's getting worse.
No. شوي شوي صار.
Is there pain?
يحس فيه.
And your older son, where is he?
ابني بالعناية مشددة هلا.
How long has he been in intensive care?
صار له نهارين.
We tried to see Yahya in the ICU, but the hospital staff wouldn't let us. This is the video that his father took for us as his son was struggling to
breathe.
How do you feel when you see him like that?
ضايع يعني عم بقدر شاد ما عم بقدر بسعى فيه ما عم بقدر ما عم بطلع شيء بايدي
Here's what we know. Abdul Ghani, his wife and 3 children were scheduled to travel to the US in December and they were going to be resettled in Buffalo, New York. But at that point, his 2-year-old son, the youngest, was too sick to fly. Abdul Ghani says their trip was later postponed to February 1st. They had a short window to make it over while both children were well enough to travel. But then their trip was cancelled. The family would not be let in. Days later, he says his older son Yahya's health took a turn for the worse. He's the one in the ICU.
كل ما بروح على المنظمات بيقولوا لي تمام انت ادوارتك مستعجل 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 ما شفت شيء مستعجل ابدا وتعذبت كثير 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 في هالمنظمات الانسانيه اللي على اساس انه منظمات مشان حقوق الاطفال وحقوق الانسان انا ما شفت هالشيء هون ابدا
انت حسيت بايه لما شفت القرار او سمعت على القرار
اتدمرت كرمال الاطفال لانه انا عايش قلت لك كرمال الاطفال
We reached out to the agencies involved in the refugee resettlement process, the International Organization for Migration, UNHCR, and the State Department. They all said they don't discuss individual cases.
وين اللي رهب فيه؟ طلق. هذا إذا ما طلع أمريكا أو على هالبلاد الأوروبية مشان يتعالج، بتدمر حياته بيموت.
After visiting her son in the ICU, Yahya's mom, Jumana, came in the room devastated. We filmed her on a phone, but she asked us not to show her face. No one in the hospital would talk to us about Yahya's condition, but we reviewed his medical files, which suggested he'd been diagnosed with a genetic disorder called Omenn syndrome, a severe immunodeficiency. According to medical records, his brother, Abdul Jawad, likely has the same condition, which can be cured with a bone marrow transplant. Their parents hope they can do the procedure in the US. The hospital the children are in now has no pediatrics unit, and the ICU is an adult facility.
If there's a chance to travel now, would you be able to travel?
In the middle of our interview, Abdul Ghani received a call from an employee with UNHCR.
وعم نحاول نعمل كل شيء بايدنا لحتى ننقل ابنكم من المكان اللي هو موجود فيه على مشفى بيتي
يا انسي الله يوفقك بعد ما بده يموت الولد هلا بدكم صرتوا بدكم تنقلوه تتعذبوا فيه صلي اكثر من 6 ايام بترجاكم تنقلوه على غير مشفى في كل اسطنبول ما بقى تستقبله وهو كان ما فيه شيء
مظبوط بس انا حبيت خبرك مثل باخر تطورات صارت معنا بعد ما حكينا مع نائب مدير الصحه تمام
ان شاء الله يعني الثاني اتصال تتصلي فيني فيه رقم بيكون ابني ميت بقول لك الله يعطيك العافيه تسلمي الدين والايمان
لا بعيد الشر
الله يعطيك العافيه
بعيد الشر الله يعافيك
بس ان شاء الله كل ساعه بتعذب فيها هذا الولد انتم بتتعذبوا فيها وانتم بتتحاسبوا فيها سكري تمام
The family is desperate for Yahya's health to improve enough so he could fly.
You're dealing with so much. How are you handling all of it?
رب العالمين اطبر لي الصبر.
Did you tell your son Yahya that you were going to the US?
No.
Can be all lucky. I'm
going to America and inshallah I'll get me medicine and treatment. And I'm like that, I understand that inshallah I'll get a doctor and go to school and start a new life, my dad, and go on your own and buy a car.
Did you break the news to him that he wasn't traveling?
No.
What did you tell him?
هو تعب من وقتها انه لانه ما بده يسافر كثير تاثر
أثر كثير والله.
Abdul Ghani and his family are among countless people who were impacted by the travel ban. The Trump administration came under fire for the way the order was rolled out and the chaos and confusion that followed. It was clear that federal agencies weren't coordinating with each other, and airport authorities seemed unsure of how to enforce it. Almost immediately, questions were raised about its constitutionality, including how green card holders could legally be barred from entering the country, and whether the ban constituted a religious test. The opposition was fierce.
Soon after Trump signed the executive order, arrival halls like this one in Dulles Airport filled up with thousands of people who came to protest the ban, and it helped spark the legal movement to overturn it.
Even after several court rulings halted the ban, people still worried they wouldn't be let in. Especially those from the affected countries without visas to the US. They lost hope they would ever get them, and many families were separated across continents.
We heard about another case of an Iraqi baby here in Michigan who's been separated from his parents. He was very badly burned in a refugee camp and came to the U.S. to get surgery. His parents now can't come join him because of Trump's executive order. Hi. I'm Sharif.
Nice to meet you.
Very nice to meet you.
The baby's being cared for by Adley Kejan.
And I have pictures of them.
A 29-year-old paramedic in Lansing, Michigan, and an advocate in the U.S. for Yazidis, a small religious community based mostly in Iraq.
And that's his father?
Yeah.
Dilberin's parents are also Yazidi. Driven from their home in northern Iraq by ISIS when his mother was still pregnant with him in 2014. Mm. On his first birthday, he was sleeping in his crib in a refugee camp when a gas heater caught fire.
The fire itself did not burn him, but it burned the plastic on the caravan, and the melted plastic fell on his face and feet, whatever was exposed of his skin, and it got burned.
In October, Dilberin and his father, Ajil, came to the US so he could have surgery. His mother, pregnant at the time, stayed behind. Ajil traveled to Iraq to be with his wife when it was time for her to give birth, but he wasn't able to return to the U.S. In January, their visas were revoked. As they appealed that decision, Trump's travel ban took effect. This left the two-year-old without either parent, and time was running out before he needed to have more surgeries.
His right eye is the main concern because the scar is covering it. We took him to his eye doctor and they said to do that. This was 3 months ago, that he needs it as soon as possible. Otherwise, he could go blind.
Could he just have the surgery while his parents are in Iraq?
To put a two-year-old through all these surgeries without his parents being here, it's like traumatizing both him and his parents.
Dilberin's doctor said he needs to have eye surgery by February 20th.
So this current separation is pretty rough on him.
Oh, definitely. Like when I try to leave, he cries. And so he has this separation anxiety. So whenever new people come, like he just, you know, he's thinking that the same thing will happen. He's gonna be taken away again. He's been separated from his mom for 5-6 months now. So he doesn't remember his mom. So when we FaceTime or talk, you know, on Skype, it's, you know, they're very tearful because their child doesn't recognize them and he doesn't want to interact with them, and it's very painful for them, but they contain it so he doesn't sense that. Hello.
Hello.
Ibarra of khair.
Bashi.
Dilberin has never met his baby brother, who was born in November on election day and who his parents named Trump because they were so grateful for their son's medical treatment in the US.
How have you been feeling having been separated from your son for so long?
Donald J. Trump is calling for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States until our country's representatives can figure out what the hell is going on. We have no choice.
Donald Trump first mentioned the idea of a Muslim ban while running for office in December 2015, in the aftermath of the San Bernardino shooting. At the time, politicians from across the political spectrum condemned the proposal, calling it discriminatory, un-American, and counterproductive. One of those people was the highest-ranking Republican, the Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan.
I do not think a Muslim ban is in our country's interest. I do not think it is reflective of our principles, not just as a party, but as a country. And I think the smarter way to go in all respects is to have a security test and not a religious test.
But after Trump's immigration order was signed, a number of Republicans, including Ryan, fell in line and announced their support for it.
There is nothing wrong with taking a pause and making sure we have the proper vetting standards in place so that we do not have a problem like France had with Paris.
We heard Paul Ryan is holding a news conference here in the Capitol, so we're gonna try and get there and get a question in.
Shoes. Do you want to come up and say Happy Valentine's Day?
Last year you said a travel ban was against our country's principles.
No, I said a Muslim ban would be against our country's principles or a religious test. This is not that.
Well, this executive order cuts off access to 200 million people, mostly Muslims.
Just to clarify, would you support...
While the debate over the ban can sometimes hinge on what to even call it, for some of Donald Trump's closest allies in Congress, there's no doubt that it's the fulfillment of the pledge he made as a candidate.
It was responsible and it was a campaign promise that he kept.
Refugees are already subject to the most rigorous vetting process of any traveler to the United States. There's months of security checks and interviews done by the FBI, Homeland Security, National Counterterrorism Center, the State Department. It takes on average 2 years. Don't you think that's enough?
I think we can still do the right thing by refugees, by the way. I don't think we should turn our back on people. Doesn't necessarily mean that we have to bring them into the United States to do that.
In Turkey, we recently met a Syrian family, refugees, who have sick children. They're in desperate need of medical treatment, and they were trying to come to the U.S. to be resettled. What would you say to a family like that that's been waiting to come here for medical care?
I sympathize, yeah, sure I do, but I sympathize with American victims. I sympathize with the American victims, so you know, we can't just give examples of on one side, but be ignorant to the Americans, innocent Americans, who expect their government to protect them first.
But aren't you worried that a blanket ban like this
harms
people who do need genuine help?
Well, it's not a blanket ban. It's a temporary pause until there's a security system. Aren't you worried about the American child and the American family who has done nothing wrong in their own country, that we have allowed people to come in to America to slip through this program or any other program and do harm? Are you arguing on behalf of everyone around the world, who feel they have a right to just come into the United States.
It's not just come in, they go through a very rigorous process already.
But it's a process developed by the United States and the country, and they have a right to say, we're not comfortable. And until we are, no, you can't.
Despite these claims, a Department of Homeland Security report obtained by the Associated Press found insufficient evidence that citizens from the seven countries affected by the immigration order posed a terror threat to the U.S. We hope to take our questions to the place the order was conceived and drafted, with seemingly little input from anyone else in the outside world.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
We've taken decisive action to keep radical Islamic terrorists out of our country. Our administration is working night and day to keep you safe, including reporters safe, and is vigorously defending this lawful order. I will not back down from defending our country. I got elected on defense of our country. And I keep my campaign promises.
President Trump stuff on the immigration order?
I wasn't called on, but another reporter asked him about the executive order.
On the travel ban, would you accept that that was a good example of the smooth running of government?
Yeah, I do. I do. Let me tell you about the travel.
Were there any mistakes in that?
Wait. We had a very smooth rollout of the travel ban. But we had a bad court, got a bad decision. What I wanted to do was do the exact same executive order, but said one thing, and I said this to my people, give them a 1 month period of time. But General Kelly, now Secretary Kelly, said, if you do that, all these people will come in the month, the bad ones. You do agree there are bad people out there, right? They're not everybody that's like you. You have some bad people out there. Now, if I would have done it a month, everything would have been perfect. The problem is, we would have wasted a lot of time and maybe a lot of lives because a lot of bad people would have come into our country. Now, in the meantime, we're vetting very, very strongly. Very, very strongly.
Mr. President, if you have no connection.
On March 6th, the Trump administration released a revised travel ban, and this time they believe it'll hold up in court. The same countries remain on the temporary ban, except for Iraq. Syrian refugees will no longer be banned indefinitely, though the entire refugee program will be suspended for 120 days. Dilbereen's parents finally got their visas after two members of Congress intervened. They reunited with their son on February 20th, the same day he was supposed to have his surgery. This was the first time he met his baby brother. Doctors have postponed his surgery until he reconnects with his parents, which could take weeks. They say the bond would make recovering from surgery less traumatic for him. On the last day we were in Istanbul, we got a message from Abdul Ghani. He told us that after 5 days in the ICU, Yahya died. He was 6 years old. These are the last pictures of him alive. Yahya was never moved from the hospital.
Did they say how he died?
من كتل من والسبب ومن كتل السلطانية اللي في الرئة وفي القناة الصفراوية.
Through multiple sources, we learned that the family's security clearance to the U.S. may have lapsed. UNHCR has told them they're now trying to move them to Germany. But as they wait for that day, Abdul Ghani and his wife are growing more desperate to get treatment for their two-year-old, who's gotten worse since his brother died. Wherever they end up, they say Yahya's death has left a hole in their lives that can never be filled.
When's the last time you
spoke to him.
الساعة 12 امبارح. بس آخر كلمة حكاها معي من خمس أيام. الله يرحمه.
قال لك إيه؟
عمل لي هيك. باي.